this course is computer programming, and we have a course website. And you can scan the QR code, or you can search DV Lab, NSYSU, and you can find our course website. Our course website is an English class, so you need to select this one, Computer Programming Thursday, because I have two courses. I have two courses about computer programming. The other one is on Wednesday, but today's course is on Thursday, so you need to use the first one, Thursday. And I'm Trouble Wei, and if you want to contact me, you can use the first email. And remember to mention your name and your student ID and your class. You are on a Thursday class. And later we will have assignments. And if you want to send assignments, you need to use the second email address. We will have four teaching assistants. Two teaching assistants are here. He is Song Yuan, and the other is Li Chengkai. And if you have questions about the course materials, or if you have questions about assignments, you can use the TA hours. And for this course, you need to write programs. So you need to you need an environment to write programs. And here are two choices. The first one is you can use online IDE to write program, or you can use offline IDE. Online means you write programs inside a browser, and here are some options. And offline IDE means you need to install some software in your laptop. And later I will introduce how to use the online IDE and how to use the offline IDE. The following is the grading policy of this course. And the midterm exam and the final exam accounts 25% of the semester grade separately. And we also have the quizzes. The quizzes accounts for 10% of the semester grade. And the assignments accounts for 40% of the semester grade. And we will have five assignments, so each assignments is accounts for 8% of the semester grade. So it is important for you to complete each assignment. And the next week we will have the first assignment. And you need to follow the rules to assign, to send assignment, and you can see this link. And I will give the link to send assignment when the assignments are announced. And the assignments are designed for beginners. So even though you have no programming experience, you are still able to complete the assignment. And if you have problems of doing the assignments, you can use the TA hours. One important thing is that you can discuss the assignments with the classmates, but you are not allowed to see their source code when doing the assignments. Such behavior constitutes plagiarism. And if we find you. If we find plagiarism, and you will get a zero for your assignments. And it is recommended that you send your assignments as early as possible. You will have three chances to send the assignments, and every week, I will update the accuracy of your assignments, and if you find a mistake in your assignments, you will have a chance to fix the mistakes before the deadline. The accuracy of your assignments will be announced on this website. I will announce your accuracy of your assignments in the news section. And we will use the app, the Ruvio app, to conduct the quiz. And if you you can use your you can use mobile phone to search the Ruvio app. But if you use Android, so if your mobile phone, the operating system of your mobile phone is Android, this app is removed by Google yesterday. But you can still use the web page. You can use the browser to find the Ruvio website. And you can log in the system. And I have created your account. The account is your student ID. And then at mail.nsysu.edu.tw. The password is 123. You can modify the default password to avoid the misuse. And if you cannot log into the system, you can create a new account by yourself. if you need to register a new account, remember to use your real name. So that I can know who you are and register your scores. And after you log into the system, you will see the course title, which is 112-1 Computer Programming Thursday. Or you can manually you can manually edit this class. The course code is this one. You can use this course code to add this class into your Rubio system. And then now I will use the Rubio to survey your background of programming. So here are three questions about the background of your programming. The first question is, which programming languages do you have experience with? And the second question is, if you know how to program, what's your programming environment? And the third question is the motivation for taking this course. So in the next week, we will have a quiz. And the quiz is like this one. We will have three questions. And each question is single choice. And let's see the survey results. For the first one, about 32% do not have the programming experience. For this course, we do not assume you have any programming experience. So it is okay that if you have no programming experience, we will learn the basics of a programming language. The second question is about the programming environment. And for this course, I will suggest to use the code blocks. The dev C++ is a bit obsolete because dev C++ is not maintained anymore. So I will suggest you to use code blocks, or you can use Microsoft Visual Studio. And the third one is about the motivation, or why you want to take this course. And about half is because this course is compulsory, and about half is about because the computer programming is interesting. You can write other reasons in the fourth option. So the next week we will use the Rubio to conduct a quiz. Like this one. And there are no makeup exams for the quizzes. So if you need to take a leave, you need to you can write email to me. And we have a textbook. The textbook is Absolute C++. And I also list the textbook agent. You can contact the textbook agent, or you can search the other textbook agents that offer a lower price. And It is not mandatory to buy the textbook, because I will put all the slides and all the assignments on this website. So it is not mandatory to buy the textbook. But if you want detailed descriptions about concepts or programming terminology, then it is good for you to have a textbook. And you don't need to have the latest version. You can also use the older one. And you can, here is the contents, table of contents. And we will cover from chapter 1 to chapter 10. So if the textbook has these chapters, then you can use this textbook. And in the button of this page is the syllabus of this course. We have 16 weeks, and I also list the date for the midterm exam and the final exam. And you can download the slides from this link. Here, REF is some reference materials. And let's see the slides. This slide is about computer programming. So first, I will explain what is a programming language. And first, we all know what is a language. A language is what we use to communicate with people. For example, in Taiwan, we use Chinese to communicate. And when you travel abroad, you might use English, Japanese, depending on the countries. And if we want to communicate with machines, we need to use a language that machine understands. And this language is called a programming language. And if we can speak a programming language, then we can communicate with machines, and we can enable machines to accomplish tasks for us. So, like languages, programming language, we have many programming languages. We have Python, Java, C++, C, and other programming languages. And for this course, we will learn the C++ programming language. And later, I will explain why I choose the C++ programming language. In this slide, I show what can be done with computer programming. And computer programming is almost everywhere. When you use your computer, your laptop, or you use the web browser, or you use your mobile phone, and you will use software. And the software is written by some programming language. So computer programming is almost everywhere. And computer programming is also used for data science and scientific research. For example, in fields like physics, biology, chemistry, we need to conduct experiments, and these experiments often modeled by some software. So you need to know how to program to conduct the experiments. And currently, artificial intelligence is very popular, and if you want to use artificial AI tools, if you want to develop algorithms for tasks like natural language processing or computer vision, you will need to know how to program. And if you know how to program, you can automatically complete the tasks. For example, you have 100 files, and you want to change the file name of each file. And if you do not know how to program, then you need to manually click each file and change the file name. But if you know how to program, you can write a for loop and a few lines to change the file name. So if you know how to program, you can do a lot of things automatically. And computer programming is also used for financial analysis, education, gaming, and entertainment. And if you watch the news, you might saw a lot of news about ChatGPT. One question is that, will ChatGPT replace programmers? And first, I will explain what is ChatGPT. ChatGPT is a large language model, LLM. And this model is a tool. He can perform a variety of NLP tasks, including to recognize, translate, predict, and generate text. So ChatGPT understand your questions because ChatGPT can recognize text, and it can also answer your questions because ChatGPT knows how to generate texts. And the programming when we write a program, we write tasks. So ChatGPT also understand programs. You can use ChatGPT to generate a program, or you can submit a program to ChatGPT to analyze your program. So ChatGPT is a tool to assist us to program. So now we have the question, will ChatGPT replace programmers? Here is the answer from ChatGPT. I asked these questions to ChatGPT, and it gives me the answer. Because programming involves communication, collaboration, and decision making, and these activities are inherently human activities. So ChatGPT cannot do these activities. But we can use ChatGPT and the other AI tools to assist us to write programs. If, for example, a popular tool is GitHub Copilot. This is an AI tool. And you just write the name of a function, then this tool can automatically fill the definition of this function. So because this tool understand the name of the function, so this tool can guess what you want to do, and automatically generate the code for this function. And for this course, I will the purpose of this course is to let you understanding the basics of a programming language. So I will not use ChatGPT, but you can use ChatGPT as a tool to assist you learn how to program. But the important point is that you know the basics of a programming language. Because if you do not have a solid understanding of the programming language, then you cannot evaluate the results of ChatGPT. You do not know the output of ChatGPT really satisfy your needs. So it is important for you to have a solid understanding of the basics of programming language. And this is the purpose of this course. Next, I will introduce the three virtues of a programmer. And when you first read this sentence, you might have some question: why the three the laziness, impatience, and hubris are virtues? You might have questions, but for a programmer, the three ones are virtues. And you can click this link to see the explanation. If a programmer is lazy, then he want to save his time. So a programmer will write labor-saving programs to save his energy and his time. So laziness is one virtue for a programmer. The second one is impatience. When a program is running, and a programmer might feel anger because he don't want to wait the program to finish. So he will try to improve his program to make his program runs more efficiently. So impatience is also a virtue for a programmer. The third one is hubris. Hubris means pride, or means pride. And as a programmer, you want others do not say any bad thing about your program, about your code. So you will write high quality codes. So the third virtue will enable you to write high quality programs. So the three ones are good virtues for a programmer. Next, let's see the ranking of programming languages. There are many programming languages, and this ranking is according to the popularity. So from this figure, the most popular one is Python. Python is popular because Python is easy to write, easy to read. And you can write a few lines to finish a task using Python. And for this course, we will learn the C++ programming language. Because this course is in the electrical engineering department, so we need to communicate with hardware. And if you want to work with hardware, you often need to use some low-level programming languages like C++. So this course, in this course, we will learn C++. Once you learn one programming language, it will be easy for you to learn another programming language. So if you if you understand how to use C++, then you can learn a second language by yourself. So you can learn Python as a second programming language. In this slide, you can click this link to see more details. And you can sort the languages according to jobs or according to trending. The next slide is another ranking website. If you are interested in this ranking, you can see this link by yourself. Next, I will talk about the evolution of programming languages. When we compare Python to C++, Python is a higher level programming language. Here, high level or low level is relative. So Python compared to C++, Python is higher level. But if we compare C++ to the assembly programming language, then C++ is higher level than the assembly programming language. And here, higher level means strong abstraction. And here, abstraction means to hide the details of the computer. So if you hide more details, then you have stronger abstraction. Later, I will use one example to illustrate what is abstraction. And in programming, abstraction means the elimination of the irrelevant and the amplification of the essential. And in other subjects, you will also see abstraction. For example, if you learn mathematics, mathematics use a lot of abstraction. But the definition of abstraction in mathematics is a bit different from the definition in programming. Here I use this slide to illustrate what is abstraction. Picasso saw a lot of so many bulls, and he want to draw sketches of the bulls, and he want to capture the essential features of bulls. So he made a lot of drawings, and he gradually refined the drawings. He removed the unnecessary parts, and then gradually he removed the redundant parts. Finally, the last picture is about what Picasso think the most essential features of a bull. And this process is known as abstraction. So abstraction is to remove the irrelevant part and to amplify the essential parts. So for Picasso, the essential features of a bull is the lines shown in the last drawing. And here is a comic about programming in Python. For the left figure, a non-programmer is like a bird and pick up stones to drink water from a bottle. So if you are a non-programmer, you want to drink water inside a bottle, you need to repeatedly pick up many small stones into the bottle to raise up the water level. So for a non-programmer, you need to do repeatedly works. But if you are a programmer, you can use programming to complete the task. So it is like you use a straw to drink water from the bottle. And for a Python programmer, it is even easier. You can sit on a chair and use a soft straw to drink the water from the bottle. Because Python is easier to write compared to other programming languages. The next slide is about the specs about C++. And layer is a committee defines the specs of the C++ programming language. And in this course, we will cover C++ 2011. And the more advanced features, such in C++ 14 or C++ 17, will not discussed because the latest feature are specific for some applications. And for this course, we will cover some basic features of the C++. So this course will cover C++ 2011. 2011 and the C++ 1998. And here I use a example to compare C++ with Python. For example, we want to create an array. And in Python, it is easy. An array means a container of many elements. So in Python, you use one line. You can use one line to create an array. But in C++, you have many methods to create an array. Method one is like Python. You only use single line to create an array. But in C++, method one is creates a static array. Static array means you cannot delete or insert elements into an array. But in Python, the array is dynamic. Dynamic means you can insert or delete elements from this array. So Python is more flexible. And in C++, if you want to create a dynamic array, you need to use method 2 or use method 3. You need to manually allocate memory to create an array, or you need to use some library like vector to help you to create a dynamic array. So Python is more flexible than C++. It is easier to write programs with Python. But C++ also has its own advantage. C++ requires less CPU time and consume less memories than Python. In the later weeks, we will learn how to use an array. And so if you do not understand this example, it is fine. And I think it's time to take a break for 10 minutes.
好，大家好，那个欢迎各位来到电机系哦。啊，我是电机系系学会的顾问陈宏光哦。那就是因为现在大家大一嘛，我顺便问一下，就是目前有买计算机的举一下手。好，也是有哦，但是看，因为啊，谢谢，手可以放下。就是计算机到后面的话，其实我们各个就是电子学啦、电路学啊、电磁学啦这些科目，其实都会做使用到。那去年的话，同学就有学，往年的话是让大家自己买了，只是同学就问说，啊，电机系那么多人，如果团购的话，看会不会比较便宜哦？那我们今年就是联合我们中山其他三大系哦，资工系、物理系还有化学系。我们跟卡西欧一起去签了一张，就是比较便宜的合约哦，然后就是开放给同学登记。那其实我们系学会本身也没有盈利啦，对，就只是说就是方便大家那个去购买，然后还有就是帮大家省，省比较省一些钱哦。那细节的话就是在传单里面。那 啊，不好意思，你们班带目前在班上吗？班带的话，方便帮我举个手吗？啊，班带就翘课，这么 啊，日本人啊，日本人，哦哦哦，Hello，好，那个晚一点我把那个链接传给你，好，然后啊再麻烦你帮我传给大家，好，谢谢。
Hello, let's continue our class. And here I will introduce C and C++. And here plus is an operator in the C programming language, and plus means plus one. So C++ is C+1. In fact, C++ is evolved from the C programming language. So, C++ includes all the features of the C language. But C++ adds some more features. For example, C++ adds the class syntax to support the object-oriented programming. And in the later weeks, we will also learn how to define your own class to perform the object-oriented programming. And in this slide is about clean code. And here, clean code means you organize your code so that others can understand what you write. So, good programmers write code that humans can understand. I will give you some examples, what is clean code and what is not. You can go to the reference link, and in the below the clean code item, you can find this one. Here is one example. This example is in written in another programming language. It's written in Java, but it is it is similar to the C++ syntax. And this example is not clean, because this example does not organize its source code. So you need to read each line in order to understand the purpose of these functions. So this is not a good style to write program. And below is another example. This example is a good example. So the style is clean. The style is clean because this function, he organized its code. He put each block inside one function. So from the function name, you can understand the purpose of each line. So for example, this line call the function include setup pages. So you know the purpose of this line is to include setup pages. And the next line is another function, calls another function. So it is important to organize your source code so that others can understand what you write. But for beginners, usually write source code like the first example. Beginners don't understand the importance of organize your source code. But if you write your program in this way, then you will hard to find the bug in your program. And it is also difficult to understand what you write. So later we will learn how to write clean code, like the second example. And here is another example about clean code. This piece of code is in the JavaScript language. You might not know the JavaScript language, but if you read the code, you can still understand the purpose of this code. For example, the first line declares a variable still alive, and its initial value is set to true. So if you are still alive, then you enter the next line. The next line is a while loop. And if still alive is true, then you will enter the while loop and perform the actions inside this loop. So if you still alive, then you will perform wear mask. Stay 6 feet apart, wash hands, and get tested. So the code is clean because it is readable. You don't need to read the details of each line to understand the purpose of this code. So it is important to write clean code. Here are some references, but this is the two ones are more advanced. You can skip the two ones. And next, I will talk about the environment for you to write program. And the environment is called Integrated Development Environment, IDE. And the IDE has two parts, has two components. The first component is a text editor. This editor is, you use this to edit any text. So any text can be used. The popular choice is like VS Code, Visual Studio. This editor is from the is separate from the Visual Studio. Another one is like Notepad++, or you can use Vim. The second component is a compiler. You will use a compiler to convert the text from text to machine code. So the purpose of a compiler is to convert your source code into executable machine code. And you will also have many options for the compiler. For example, on Windows, you can use MINGW, and on Linux, we often use GCC. But if it is inconvenient, if you download each one separately, because you need to, when we write program, we need to combine the two components. So we usually use IDE. And IDE provides the text editor and a compiler. Here are some suggestions. This is offline IDE. You can use core blocks. And below are some options. Here are some options. You need to choose the one with a compiler. So you can choose this one. This one has a compiler, MINGW compiler. And if your operation system is Mac is iOS, then you can consider using Xcode. Xcode is native, so you don't need to download any software if you use Mac. And some students have problem about installing the software. So another option is you can use the online IDE. So you can write program inside a browser. I will show how to use the online IDE. It is simple. Here you can edit your text, and after you finish the editing, you can click run. And at the end of the page will be the output of your program. So for example, this program outputs a string, hello world. So you will see the program output is hello world. And you can change the output string, and then compile and run again. So the output changes to hello world to C++. And you can also download the code, or you can click the download code button to download the CPP file. So you can either use the online IDE or you can use offline IDE to write programs. Both are okay for you to write the assignments. And next, I will talk about how you convert the text file to executable machine code. We use the text editor to write a program to edit text. Then we will save the text in a file, and the file extension is usually CPP. CPP means C++. Or the other option is .h. H means header. So if you want to define your own library, you usually include the function definition in a header file. But for beginners, we often use CPP. So I will show you one example for you. Now suppose I use the code blocks. After you installed the code blocks, then you can use a file new and empty file. And it takes some time to wait for the program to start, and now we click file new and empty file. Then you can copy the program. You can copy the program to a text file. Now suppose the file name is hello.cpp. And then after you save the file, you will find the hello.cpp. After you save the text file, then you will see hello.cpp. And you can open this file with any text editor. Here I use Vim to open this text file, or you can use other text editor. For example, the Notepad. You can also use Notepad to open this file. And then we need to compile this file. So compile, you can click this button, build. Build means you use a compiler to convert the text file into a machine executable code. So after you click the build button, and you will see some message in the button. So then after you build this this CPP file, you will find some outputs. The compiler will generate hello.o and hello.exe. And the hello.exe is the executable code. And you can execute the hello.exe. And you need to click this run button. If you click the run button, then the operating system will execute the hello.exe, and you can see the program outputs. So for this program, the program outputs hello world to C++. And if you change your source code, for example, I change C++ to Java, then you need to rebuild your program. And you can also click one button. There is a button build and run, so you can click this build and run to see the new program outputs. I will illustrate the process of converting a CPP file to a executable machine code. So after you finish editing a CPP file, then you use a compiler. And this compiler will pre-process your CPP file. Pre-process often means to include the header. The header is like this one. The compiler will include the IO stream library. And then the compiler will use assembler to turn your CPP file into assembly code. Assembly code means low level code. You can search some example. So assembly code like this one contains some low level operations like CMP for example MOV is a low level operation. And then the machine code the assembly code will be transformed into machine code. Machine code is like 0001. This is machine code. And then the compiler will link the library with your code. For example, in this example, I use cl, and the cl is in IO stream. So the compiler will link the IO stream library with my own code, and to create the final executable machine code. For compiler, the compiler will use the following steps to convert a text file into an executable machine code. And usually when you use the IDE, you won't notice this process because you simply click the button. But when you click this button, the background process is the compiler do automatically do these steps for us. And in this page shows how you can also manually perform this task, but this is more difficult because you need to manually compile the CPP file and manually execute the executable. So for example, if you want to do this manually, you need to use the command line cmd. Then you use cmd to go to the folder the folder containing your CPP file. Then you use the command line to compile your file, like the following one. After you execute this command line, then the compiler will generate the executable, and then you need to invoke the executable to see the program outputs. So this is more difficult. So usually I will suggest you use an IDE to write program. For example, you can use CodeBlocks, or you can use online IDE. And if you want to see more details about the compilation process, you can see the links in the provided by the slide, but I will skip this one. So we have finished the course introduction, and next I will introduce the basics of the C++ programming language. So let's see the second slide. And in this chapter, we will learn the basics of the C++ programming language, including the concept of variables, and what is an expression and what is a statement. And we will also learn how to use the console input-output. Console input is Cin, and the console output is Cout. And first, let's see how we use programming to solve real problems. And when you see a problem, when you meet a problem, then first you will come up with some solution idea to solve this problem. And then you need to turn this idea into some pseudo code or some steps, and we will call this pseudo code an algorithm. And after you have the algorithm, you need to turn the algorithm into a program. So the process from an algorithm to a program is known as programming. So this course will teach you how to convert a program an algorithm into a program. So after you after this course, you should be able to convert an algorithm into a CPP file. Then after we have a CPP file, then we use a compiler to automatically convert the program into executable machine code. And this is the process from problems to solutions. But if your problem is very complex or very difficult, the solution idea might not be obvious. Then you need to search some solutions. For example, you can search some well-known algorithm textbooks to find whether if there is some algorithms can be used. Next, let's see a sample C++ program. And if you use the online IDE, it will in default, it will give you a template. For example, if we use the online GDB, then by default, you will have a template. You will have this template. This template only do one thing. This template output a string hello world in the console. And after you compile and run the file, you can see the program output at the bottom of this page. This program is a bit complex because this program has many keywords like include, using namespace, or main int main function. This is very complex. It takes some time to explain every details. So I will skip this one. I will only talk about this line C out. For this example, you only need to understand this line. This line means when you use double quote. Double quote means a data type. This data type is a string in the C++ programming language. So you can use double quote to create a string in C++. Then we use this operator. This is called the left shift operator. This one is one operator. In C++, we have many operators. And like plus plus is an operator, and minus is another operator. And for this one is left shift, because it performs a bitwise shift. Later we will explain about this operator. We also have the right shift operator. But for this line, for this statement, this operator, the action is not left shift. The action means redirect. this operator redirect this string to the the console cout. So cout is a variable defined in the IO string library, and when you execute this statement, then this statement means this string will be redirected by this operator to the console output. And you can add, you can concatenate more outputs. For example, you can output another string. And you can also output another data type. For currently we only output the string data type. You can only you can also output other data type like integer, or you can output. Or you can output a floating point. So the next line, first I output another data type. This data type is integer, which is 123. And if you want to add a new line, you can use end L. End L means a new line character. End L is defined in the IO string library. So if you include this library, you can use CL and end L. So after we output a new line, then I output the floating point 3.14. So we can use the cout to output many data type. You can output a string, or you can output integer, you can output a floating point. And for this example, first I output a string, 123. And the next I output another, an integer, 123. The output of the two lines are the same, but the meaning are different. The meaning of the first line is, it outputs a string. So this string will be the data type of this string is different from the data type of integer, and the data type will affect the memory space. So although the two outputs are the same, but the memory used are different for each line. And later we will introduce what is a string and what is an integer. For integer, you can perform mathematical operations like plus. But for strings, if you perform plus, you cannot perform plus. Because for a string data type, This is C string, and the C string does not support the plus operation, so you cannot perform the plus to C string. But we can perform plus to integer because integer support mathematical operations. So 123 plus 456 is 579. So if you want to perform the addition, then you need to use the integer data type, or you need to use the floating data type. You cannot use the string data type to perform addition. Next, let's talk about two concepts, syntax and semantics. Syntax means the rules for writing the language. It is like the grammar. So if you want the computer, the compiler to understand what you write, you need to follow the syntax. If you made a mistake, the compiler will issue some error messages. For example, in this line, in C++, when we want to finish this line, we need to add a semicolon. And if you forget to use the semicolon, then the compiler will show some error message because this line because your program does not follow the syntax. And the error message is in this line, the sixth line, and the compiler expects a semicolon before this return statement. So the compiler expects a semicolon in this position. So it is easy for you to find a syntax error because the compiler will tell you where is wrong. And in the C++ programming language, the space does not affect the program output. So you can remove all space like this. You can remove this space. And the program output is still the same. But why I use this space? Because this space can increase the readability of this program. So typically, I will use I will add some proper spaces after the operators to increase the readability. And this space will not affect the program outputs. And actually, you have another choice. You can click the Beautify. Beautify will automatically format your program. For example, here I might type. For example, I type this statement, and this statement is difficult to read because this statement have no proper indent and space, and you can use the Beautify function, this function, and you will 8, this beautify will automatically insert proper indent and the proper space to make your program more readable. And next, let's talk about what is semantics. Semantics means the intention of your code. Semantics means the intention of your code. And because compiler do not know our intention, so compiler cannot find the semantic error. So semantic error is difficult to find. To be found. Here, I will use one example to illustrate what is a semantic error or a semantic gap. For example, I want to show the output of 1 divided by 2. Then do you know what will be output in the screen? What is the output of this operation? The 0.5. If you have no programming experience, your answer might be 0.5. And let's see the program outputs. The output is not 0.5. The output is 0. So if you do not understand this code, if you do not understand this operation, this will create a semantic gap. Because if you think the output is 0.5, but actually the output is 0. So the output is different from your expectation, and this is called a semantic gap. And the compiler cannot detect the semantic gap, the semantic error. Because the code is legal, the syntax of this code is legal, so you can compile and run this program. But this program does not output what you want. And if you want to, and later we will talk about this this division. If you want to output 0.5, you need to use floating point. Or you can change the numerator or the denominator to a floating point, then this division will perform the floating point division. And if you change the numerator to a floating point, then the output is 0.5. So it is difficult to find a semantic error because the compiler cannot find a semantic error for us. You need to it is important that you understand what you write. If you don't understand what you write, the program might output something unexpected. And I think we can take a break for 10 minutes. Hello, and let's continue our class. Next, I will talk about two terminology, expressions and statements. If you read the textbook, you will find you will see the two words many times. And first, what is an expression? An expression means anything that it generates a value. Anything is usually a sequence of operations. For example, you perform a mathematical operation like a plus, multiply, or subtraction. So A plus B times 3 is an expression. And the comparison is also an expression. After you compare A with B, then this expression will generate a value, true or false. If A is greater than B, then this expression generates true. And if A is less than or equal to B, then this expression generates false. And later we will talk about this operation. This is known as comparison. And comparison will generate a Boolean value. And you can also use call a function, call a sine function. And the sine function will return a floating point. And you can use the floating point to perform addition. So this sequence of operation also generates a value. And the assignment operation also generates a value. If you assign B to A, then this expression will generate the value of B. So the assignment is also a expression. Next, let's talk about statement. Statement is the fragments of a program. So for a program, we will have many statements. There are two types of statements. The first type is a single line statement, like this one. If the statement is terminated by a semicolon, then this statement is a single line statement. So the second one is also a single line statement. And the second type is the compound statement. Compound statement is usually compound statement is appear in the if block or the for block. And later when we learn the two when we learn the flow control, like if or for, we will see the syntax. And this type of statement is known as the compound statement. A compound statement means more a combination of two or more statements. In fact, the compound statement can be empty. Inside the brace can be empty. So, but usually, compound statement means a combination of two or more statements. And next, let's see what is a variable. A variable is an important concept in programming language. When we write program, we usually need to define variables. And a variable means a memory location you use to store the data. So in order to use a variable, you need to declare. Declare means to create a variable. So in C++, if you want to use a variable, you need to declare a variable. For example, here, suppose I want to use A. I want to use variable A, and I assigned a value to this variable A, and then I output a value of A. And this is illegal because I do not follow the syntax. You can see the error message. The error message is A was not declared in this scope. Because if we want to use a variable, we need to declare. So the proper syntax is to declare this variable first. In the not every programming language needs to declare a variable before its use. Some programming language like Python do not need to declare a variable. But for the C++ programming language, you need to declare a variable before using the variable. And when we want to declare a variable, first you need to write a data type. Data type is like integer, double. Double is a floating point. So first you need to decide the data type you want to use. For example, I want to declare an integer. Then first I write int. Int means integer. So first you write a data type. Then follow the data type is the variable name. You can use any variable name, but you need to follow some rules. Later we will introduce. Here you can use almost any name. And after we declare a variable, then we can start to use this variable. Here I use one example. For example, I declare a variable x, and I assign some value to this variable. Then I want to perform some operation like addition, x plus 20. And you can also declare more variables in one line. And if you want to declare more variables, you can use the comma operator. So after the first variable, you can add a comma, and then you declare the second variable. So you can declare x, y, and z. And the variable name, has some. You need to follow some rules. The rules is defined in this page, in this slide. The variable name is called an identifier. So because the name of a variable is identity, so we also call the name of a variable as an identifier. And if you want to define the variable name, you need to follow this rule. This rule is you can only use letters A to Z and the digits 0 to 9 and the underscore symbol. Underscore is this one. Underscore symbol. You can only use the three types of symbols to define a variable name. So the legal identifier is like this. You can use x1 or x underscore 1. These are legal variable names. And there is one additional rule. The additional rule is that the identifier must start with either a letter or an underscore. This means the identifier cannot be start with a digit. So if you start the variable name with a digit, then this is illegal. So you cannot use 3x as a variable name. You can do the experiment. For example, I want to declare 3x. For example, you can try to declare 3x, and this is illegal. Because this identifier is unqualified, because it is does not follow the rule to declare a variable. But you can use x3. X3 is variable, is legal, because 3 is not in the first letter. You can use underscore, and for example, you can begin with underscore. This type of variable name is also legal. So below are some illegal examples. For example, you cannot use the minus. You can not use the dot. You cannot use other symbols like the percentage symbol. So the following are not legal variable names. Because if you use a variable name like this, data minus one, this will be ambiguous. Ambiguous means the compiler does not know this means a variable. Data minus one is a variable, or data minus one means the variable data minus the integer one. So the C++ does not allow a variable name like this, because this will lead to some ambiguous semantics. And in C++, the identifier are case sensitive, which means the upper case or lower case are different. So the following three variable names are different, even though they are great, but the case are different. So the three ones are different variables. So you can declare a rate and you can declare two rates like this example. This is legal. But you cannot use the same variable names. For example, I use the same name rate twice. The first one is an integer, the second one is a double. But this is not legal because because this will cause a conflict. Because you have two variable and the names are the same. So this will cause a conflict. But if you change the name, for example, you change it to uppercase, then this is legal because the two names are different in C++. But we do not suggest you write program like this. This is difficult to understand because the two variable names are very similar. This will cause confusion. So we do not suggest you write a program like this, although this is legal. And below are some suggestions to have a good variable name. Like you can combine two words like top speed, bank rate. And for the second word, we will usually use uppercase. So that you can distinguish the first and the second word. So we will usually have variable names like this one. So you can declare variables like bank. You can use bank rate. Or you can use underscore. You can also use underscore. This is better than you simply use rate or use R to denote a variable. So this one is much better than the following two, because the first one gives much information about what you want to do. If your variable name is like this, this means you want to use this variable to store the value of bank rate. But for the following two, you cannot know the intention of these two variables, because if you use R, you do not know what is the purpose of this variable. So if you use a good variable name, this can makes your program more readable. So I will suggest you write program use good variable names. This can increase the readability of your program. So below is a good convention to follow. And some words are keywords or reserve words, and you cannot use these as names for variables. Like keywords, like if for, go to, switch, return. These are keywords. Keywords will be. So here return is a keyword, and return is used when you define a function. And in the later course, we will show you how to define a function. So you cannot use return as a variable name. You can see the text editor highlight the return because return is a keyword. If you try to use return as a variable's name, then you will see the error message like this. Because this name is unqualified. But you can change the later the case to uppercase, and this is legal because the two returns are different because this one use uppercase in the first letter, but we do not suggest you use variable name like this because this is confusing. There are some words like see in or see out. See in and see out are not keywords. But see in and see out are predefined words. Predefined means the two variables are defined in some library. For example, see in and see out are defined in the IOStream library. You can redefine the see in and see out because they are not keywords. So here you can redefine see in, see out. This is legal. But after you redefine see out, then you cannot use see out to output strings. So after you redefine cout as an integer variable, then you cannot use cout to output strings. But if I comment out this statement, then you can use cout to output the string. So we do not suggest you to redefine predefined words because this will cause confusion. Although you are allowed to redefine, but this is not recommended. Next, I will introduce some simple data types. Simple means built-in. These data types are built in the C++ programming language. And there are also some data types defined in the library. And later we will introduce these non-simple data types. And the simple data types can be divided into four categories. The first one is integers. The second one is floating point. The third one is characters, and the fourth one is boolean. And let's talk about the first one, integers. And inside this category, you have many options. You can use short, int, or long. The three ones are can also all can be used to be store integers, but their memory size are different. For int, the memory size is 4 bytes. While for the long data type, its memory size can be 4 bytes or eight bytes, depending on your operation system. So usually, the memory size of long is larger than that of the integer, and the memory size of the integer is greater than that of the short data type. And when we use the integer, and we have another options. This options is called unsigned. Unsigned means only non-negative values. So unsigned, you can use unsigned to store zero to store positive values, but you cannot use unsigned to store negative values. So here, I declare a variable x, and the x can be used to store negative or positive values. So you can assign negative one to x. So we see that the value in variable x is negative one. But if you declare this variable, you use unsigned. You also see the auto completion. When I type un, then the text editor will show a menu for you to select which keyword you want to use. So there are many keywords begins with U, like unsigned using UINT. So here you can select unsigned. And if you declare X as unsigned integer, and you try to assign negative one to x, this will cause some unexpected results. Here, if you use a cl to print the value of x, you will find the output is not negative one. The output is some large number. This is called overflow. And if you learn another course, we'll tell you the reason why you assign a negative number to an unsigned integer will cause an overflow. So it is important to choose the proper data type. So if you want to deal with negative numbers, you cannot use unsigned int. And you might think why do we need to use the unsigned version? You can always choose int. You can always choose the signed version. Is anyone know why we need the unsigned version? Very good. Because we have limited memory space. If you choose unsigned version, then you can store larger numbers. So this is the reason why you want to the unsigned data type. And the unsigned only used for integer. For floating point, we have no unsigned. The floating point is always signed. So for floating point, we have no unsigned version, because the floating point use another mechanism to represent a number. Later we will see the floating point. And similarly, for the floating point, we have many data type like float, double, long double. The difference is that the memory space for the three data type are different. Float is smaller, and the float may be 4 byte, and the double is 8 byte. Long double may be 8 byte or 16 bytes. And the size of the integer data type may be different on different machines. For example, the long data type has different memory size on the 32-bit system and on Unix 64-bit system. And this will cause some problem. This will cause some problem, because this will make your program not portable. Because if your program, you use long in your program, and the program is 4 byte, it can only support 4 byte memory on the 32-bit system, and this can limit the size. The range of this of this data type. So this will cause a problem for you to transfer your program from one operating system to another. And in view of this, the C++ 2011 has defined another more accurate data types. The data types is like this. This is more accurate because this data type tells you the size of its data type. So int 8 means this data type has 8 bits, and 8 bits is 1 byte. And U means unsigned. So unsigned int 8 also means this data type has 8 bytes. So 8 bytes corresponds to 1 byte. And the difference between the two data type is that its size range is different. For this signed version, its size range is from negative 128 to 127. But for this unsigned version, its size range is from 0. Because unsigned, you cannot use negative. So for unsigned data type, it begins from 0. to 255. From this table, we see that the size range of int 8 and unsigned int 8 are different, but the number of elements are the same. The number of elements in this size range is 256, and the number of elements in this size range is also 256. If you want to know a reason, you can do some simple mathematics. For example, we have 1 byte. 1 byte means 8 bits, and each bit can store either 0 or 1. So the combination, you combine 8 bits. Each bit can store 0 or 1. So 8 bits can represent 256 number of variations. And similarly, you can C++ 11 defines other data type with more larger memory size. For example, int 32 underscore t has 4 bytes. 4 bytes means 32 bits. And the unsigned int 32 has also 4 bytes. And its size range is from 0 to 2^32. 32 is the number of bits. So we have 32 bits, and you need to minus 1 because we begin from 0. So here minus 1 is due to we begin from 0. And for the signed version, you need to include the negative number. So here, for the negative version, we start from negative 2 raised to 31. 31 is 32 minus 1, because the range is divided by 2. And the upper limit is 2^31, and we need to include minus 1 because 0 is included. So here we also need to use minus 1. So you can use this rule to calculate the size range. So for this one is 2^8 minus 1. So 2^7 is 128, and if you minus 1, we get this number. And this one is the same, negative 2 raised to 8. So 2^8 is 128. So if you know the memory size, you can determine its size range. This is for the integer data type. Next, let's see the floating point. We cannot use integer to represent a floating point, but this is legal. You can assign a floating point number to an integer, but the integer variable will only save the integer part. So if you assign a floating point to an integer variable, you will find the variable can only represent the integer part. If we want to deal with floating point numbers, we need to use floating data type. So here we can use the float, or you can use double. The difference is that the memory size is different. You can use the keyword size of to see the memory size of float and the memory size of double. So for the float data type, this data type has 4 bytes, and for the double data type, this data type has 8 bytes. And the larger memory size means the size range is larger. And for the float data type, its size range is from 10 raised to negative 38 and to 10 raised to 38. And the floating point use a different mechanism to represent a number. This mechanism is shown in the following figure. So for example, the float has 32 bits, and the first bit is a signed bit used to represent its negative or positive. And the following 8 bit is the exponent. The 8 bit will be used to represent to the exponent, like 38 is a exponent. And the remaining 23 bits will be used to represent the fraction. And I will not go into the details because this is belongs to another course. And you can take a look at if you want to know why the size range is like this, or why the precision is like this, actually you can calculate by yourself. You can see for example, here is the conversion between the number in base 2 and to the number in base 10. So from this conversion, you can understand why the size range is like this. And I think the time is almost up, so we can end our class here.